Subscribe and click the bell icon for the latest updates and notifications from the Indian Express.
Hi, Purva and I are here to discuss the protests that are happening across the country and many universities against the Citizenship Amendment Act, or the CAA. Several states led by opposition parties at the moment, they have been claiming they will not allow NRC plus CAA to be implemented in their states. Do states have the right to block that?
So if you look at the 7th schedule, the union list clearly says that citizenship, naturalization and aliens, this as a subject is under the legislative domain of the parliament.
Yeah.
So states do not have a right to legislate on these issues.
Yeah.
So theoretically, no, states can't block these laws. But the implementation of these laws will depend a lot on the state machinery.
Mm-hmm.
The district collectors will have powers and who report to the state government, of course. So you will see a lot of discordance in implementing it per se, mm-hmm. if the state government wishes. But this will also be another subject matter of challenge in the Supreme Court,
yeah.
about how a federal structure and the nature of the federal polity in India will be discussed again. Can state governments block a law made by the parliament? We've seen the court say that they can't do so in cases of the National Food Security Act. So in 2017, you had a judgment given by Justice Madan Lokur where when certain states, including Gujarat, had not implemented the National Food mm-hmm. Security Act, he questioned whether these states are a part of India. So that will be another significant question raised if the states block the implementation of these laws.
And there are a bunch of petitions in the Supreme Court against it now. As the legal challenges to the CAA are set to grow, how do you think it can play out in the Supreme Court?
So you already have about a clutch of petitions in the Supreme Court right now, and significantly the one filed by the All Assam Students Union will be one of the most important ones.
Mm-hmm.
Apart from that, lawyers today, they had an informal meeting outside the court, and I think they're expecting about 100 to 150 petitions in total. So by the end of the week, the challenges will be filed, a number mm-hmm. of challenges will be filed. And then it'll be upon the court to sort of give them time and fix a hearing and schedule it. Like we've seen in the last 2 years, this has been the major problem when it comes to constitutional challenges before the Supreme Court. The issue is being heard on time and being decided on time. So that'll be the first key challenge. And given that the issue concerns many aspects of the constitution, and especially citizenship, it will require a bench of 5 judges or more. So the court to allocate 5 judges to this issue, and when they hear it, will be the first big hurdle.
So it will be a constitutional bench, that
it
means?
It will be a constitutional bench.
So what are the most of these challenges about? Like, what are they challenging in this act?
So if you look at the Citizenship Amendment Act itself, like we saw the debates in Parliament, challenges categorically on 2 basic aspects. One is that it violates Article 14 of the Constitution, which guarantees right to equality mm-hmm. and equal protection of laws. So any law that violates fundamental rights, which Article 14 is one of them, it will be declared unconstitutional by the courts. So that is the first challenge, that the law arbitrarily selects 3 countries, which the Home Minister says are theocratic countries which have Islam as their state religion.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say everyone has an equal protection of laws, the challenge will be whether Muslims from these countries can be accorded the same protection of laws that Hindus, Parsis, Buddhists and the 6 religions that the Home Minister states. So that will be one primary challenge. The other challenge is, of course, whether citizenship can be granted on the grounds of religion.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a debate that the Constituent Assembly had in particular, and in absolute terms negated this idea
yeah.
that citizenship be granted to a particular religion, or the nomenclature be in such a way that it says this religion gets priority
based
over
on religious lines essentially.
So that will be the two big tests, whether mm-hmm. the founding fathers envisaged a constitutional scheme where a religion gets priority in being Indian citizens or not.
Yeah. Apurva, you mentioned that one of the things that they're challenging is that it might be in contravention of Article 14.
Mm-hmm.
So can you just explain, is Article 14 the rights that it guarantees, are they only applicable to Indian citizens or people in general, like anybody?
So the language of Article 14 doesn't begin with a citizen or a non-citizen. It
mm-hmm.
says the state shall not. So the responsibility is on the state to not make laws which are unequal for
anyone.
The country.
Yeah.
So, but the settled principle, like if you look at case laws that the Supreme Court has evolved, it does restrict in some sense Article 14 to citizens
mm-hmm.
and Article 21, which is right to life and liberty, which will be extended to
everyone,
whether you're a citizen or not. But the legal challenge here would be that if you can't differentiate, if you can't make unequal laws for citizens, can you make unequal laws in granting citizenship?
Or potential citizens.
Or potential citizens. Because citizenship is not just a title that you give to somebody. Mm. It is a bundle of rights that come with citizenship.
Right.
So whether it could be the right to have residence in India or a slew of laws, or if you talk about economic and social protection that the state gives you in the country, citizenship is not just in itself a right, but a bundle of rights that are clubbed together.
Yeah.
So the question will be whether the state can create unequal laws in granting citizenship. So that will be the challenge for Article 14.
Okay. The other thing that some people are mentioning is that Assam is protesting because it contravenes certain segments of the Assam Accord.
Assam.
And ASU was, of course, one of the main organizations that was agitating before the Assam Accord was signed, and they're still agitating.
Yeah.
So do you think it contravenes any aspects of the Assam Accord?
So Assam Accord, significantly Section 6, which basically gives constitutional legislative protections to the people of Assam.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, there is now a debate going on as to who are these Assamese people. But if you just look at the language of Section 6, it says that they have to be protected, and that's the guarantee that the government of India makes to the people of Assam. So that is a significant question that ASU in its petition also brought up. And the second thing is it also talks about the rights of indigenous people.
Mm-hmm.
So in Assam, the Assam Accord was based on this premise that it would protect indigenous people of Assam. So that will be a significant question, and these are the two grounds that people of Assam will have to particularly fight out in the Supreme Court.
But also what they're protesting is that it changes the cutoff date from 1971 June to December 13, 2014,
14, yeah.
Which is also a major contention for the Assamese people,
yeah.
Right?
So even when the Assam Accord was signed, the cutoff date was a big bone of contention.
Yeah.
In fact, they extended it to 71. Initially, the demands were up to 51, and then they went again for a decade, and then eventually they settled at 71.
Yeah.
So now to extend that to 2014 would be unacceptable for Assamese,
yeah.
And that will be one of the bone of contentions that the court will have to decide.
Sure.
Alternatively, there is also this Section 6A of the Citizenship mm-hmm. Act itself, which is a 1955 Act, which is already pending before the Supreme Court. The validity of the Assam Accord and the cutoff date that was decided in the Assam Accord are separately pending in the Supreme Court. So this initially was coupled with the NRC petitions,
yeah.
But later had been delinked. A constitution bench will have to decide that issue as well. So the issue of Assam will take center stage in whatever constitutional challenge there will be for the Citizenship Amendment Act.
A lot of people who are protesting against the CAA, they are coupling it with NRC. Is it as troubling as a standalone act, or does coupling it with NRC make it more dangerous?
I think it's both. In itself, the CAA is troublesome. Legally, there is a lot of ground to debate on this. But coupled with the NRC, it becomes even more dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
It becomes an enabling law to disenfranchise an Indian citizen,
mm-hmm.
or disenfranchise a person who's claiming citizenship,
yeah.
in India. So, but the court will probably detangle this issue, mm-hmm. look at CAA separately. But although you will see lawyers arguing that this will be a colorable legislation when you couple it with NRC,
yeah.
that the government's intentions will be portrayed in the court differently when you look at it along with NRC.
Yeah. Great, great. Thank you.